But I'm only going to do eight today. Aren't you glad? It's the longest psalm, 176 verses, and I think that all of the verses except for two have to do with God's Word. Only two of them out of all those verses don't revolve around the Word of God. Now, let me show you something before we read. Let me show you something about Psalm 119 that you might know, but you might not know. I'm going to do it in English, so it's a little bit easier to understand rather than Hebrew. Okay, everybody knows the English alphabet, A, B, C, D, E, F, H. Anyway, everybody knows that alphabet. Okay, now, in Hebrew, the way that they would help them to memorize this long psalm is they started each section, each of the 22 sections, because there's only 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. And the first letter in Hebrew of the first eight verses, like all these verses we're reading today, if you could read the Hebrew Bible, you would notice they all begin with the first Hebrew letter, which is Aleph. And in English, it's A. And the one for B in Hebrew is Bet or Beth. And then there's the third section. Okay, so you got all the verses. And so they would go A, verses 1 through 8. They all begin with A. It would be like in English if you said, Psalm 119:1, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It would start with A. And then verse 2, acclaim and glory and joy. You know, all the words would begin with A. And so Hebrews, we don't see it in our Bible because we don't have a Hebrew Bible, but that's the way their Bibles would look. So they would have all of these, all of the letter B, all the letter C, letter D, letter E, F, G, all the way through the whole alphabet. Eight verses, all beginning with those letters. So that's how Psalm 119 is configured. Just that, that's just for your benefit, just to know that. It's kind of interesting. Now, what about the context? What's going on? What's going on in Psalm 119? Alright, what's going on here is something is really bothering the psalmist because he's ashamed. He's saying, Lord, if I could do this, then I would not be ashamed. So something is humiliating him. Something's bothering him. And he needs deliverance from something in his life because in the end of the passage we're going to read today, he says, do to God, do not forsake me utterly. Now, we don't talk like that. That's in the negative sense. If we said it positively, we might say something like this, oh God, deliver me completely from this. So he's humiliated, he's struggling, and he's also needing deliverance. He needs rescue by God from something. And you know what? I think all of us, if we were honest this morning, are here today and say, Lord, I need that too. Okay, so let's read this together, starting with verse 1. Blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with the whole heart. They also do no iniquity. That word means wrong. They don't do wrong. They walk in his ways. You have commanded us to keep your precepts diligently. By the way, let me pause here so you get an idea. Okay, I'm going to go back one slide. We got the law. What's the law of the Lord? The Bible. What are his testimonies? What are his testimonies? What's his witness? The Bible. By the way, what was the Ark of the Covenant called? You watch Indiana Jones, you saw the Ark of the Covenant and the name after Indiana Jones. But anyway, the Ark of the Covenant, it was called the Ark of Testimony. Why? What did they put in? The two tablets. They put in the testimony. That's God's Word, the Ten Commandments, the testimony. They put those in there inside the Ark of the Covenant. So you've got the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who walk in the Bible. Blessed are those who obey the Bible, keep his testimonies. They walk in his ways. Your precepts, your word, the Bible, your statutes, the Bible, your commandments, the Bible. Everything's the Bible in Psalm 119. There's a bunch of different phrases that are referring to the Bible, and they all have a little bit of a nuance. They all mean something a little bit different, but basically they're talking about God's Word. Because, you know, the Bible sometimes is law. The Bible is sometimes wisdom literature, like Proverbs. The Bible is sometimes poetry. The Bible, you get the idea. Okay, so here the psalmist says, "You've commanded us to keep your precepts diligently. Oh, that my ways, oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. Then I would not be ashamed when I look into all your commandments. I will praise you with uprightness of heart when I learn all your commandments. I will praise you." "I will keep your statutes. Oh, do not forsake me utterly." In other words, again, "Oh Lord, deliver me. Deliver me from this." Okay, let's tell a story. We're going to get back into the text here, but I want to share a story with you. I probably told this to you years ago, but I want to go back to it because it's a great story for this text we're reading today. There was a Christian university student who shared a room with a Muslim university student. As they became friends, the Christian and the Muslim, they began to talk about their beliefs. So what do you as Christians believe? Well, what do you as Muslims believe? They began to interact about these things. The believer asked the Muslim if he had ever read the Bible. Okay? So that's the Christian guy there. He's saying, "Hey, have you ever read the Bible?" The Muslim university student, "No." He said, "Did you ever read the Quran?" Now, you say, "Well, why is the Quran backwards like that? Why is it backwards?" It's because, just like the Hebrew Bible, the words, they read their Bibles from right to left. And the words start on this end of the word. Like our words end over on the right side. You read the word from left to right. They read it backwards. So their sentences start here. They go to this line. Then they go back down here and they read their words. Their words are backwards from ours. Isn't that lovely? Lovely. I'm glad I don't have to read it backwards. That would be hard. But anyway, so obviously that's not true of the Korans that are in English. Okay. But anyway, the believer said to the Muslim university student, "No, I've never read the Koran." He said, "Hey, how about this? Why don't you read the Bible? And we'll pick out a passage and we'll both read that for a week or two, and then we'll reverse. Then we'll open the Quran and you and I will read the Quran for a week or two and we'll discuss these things." He says, "I'd like to do that. Let's do that. Let's read each other's holy book." Alright? And so the Muslim young man accepted the challenge. Their friendship deepened. They got to be closer and closer as friends. And believe it or not, during the second semester that year, during the second semester, the Muslim student became a born-again believer in the Lord Jesus. He got saved. Now, this is so funny. He gets saved. He now knows what the Bible says. He knows what the true God says about eternal life. He comes running in the room one night. He comes running in the room, and he says this: "You deceived me! You deceived me!" And the Christian guy says, "I didn't deceive you. What are you talking about?" He said, "Look," he opened his Bible. He says, "I've been reading through the Bible like you told me. I'm a new believer. I should read the Bible." He said, "I read this verse. It says, the Word of God is alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword." It's alive. He said, "You know what? You deceived me. You knew that, didn't you? You knew that when you had me start reading the Bible." He says, "The Quran is not alive. The Quran is not living." He said, "God's Word is living, and that's why I've become a believer." He said, "You deceive me." And here's what the Christian guy said. He said, "Well, and now you're going to hate me for life? Now you're going to hate me for life because I deceived you?" And this is what the Muslim said to me. He said, or the former Muslim, he said, "No, but it was an unfair contest. It was an unfair contest." And of course, he wasn't mad at him or anything. He's just, you know, he's just laughing along with him that, "Hey, listen, I got, I, you know," he said, I started reading the Bible, and I didn't realize this is the power of God, the wisdom of God Almighty. Now, you know what? The Bible, our Bibles are amazing, amazing, amazing books. The Bibles that we have are incredible. The reason for that is that our Bible came from God Himself. Our Bibles came from God Himself. I can give you 20 characteristics. I'm just going to give you three real quickly, right here at the beginning. The Bible is an amazing book because, for one reason, is that it's unique. There is no book like it in the entire world. Listen, you can barely get a book that has two or three authors writing on the same subject, where if the first guy writes in chapters 1, 2, and 3, and the next guy writes in chapters 3, 4, and 5, and the next guy writes in 6, 7, and 8, there's kind of some dissonance there. This guy might say something that the second guy doesn't, and there's some issues there. But you know, the Bible is unique. It was written by many, many different authors. But of course, it's a divine book. It's inspired by God. That's why the Quran wasn't inspired by God. Muhammad wrote the Quran through others. You know, he apparently was illiterate. He didn't read or write. But he spoke the Quran to people who wrote it down. But God wasn't giving him that help like he did when the Bible was written. And by the way, the Quran is full of inconsistencies and, in fact, just outright contradictions. There's lists of these contradictions. You know, one place God created like this, and another place He created like that. It's not consistent like our Bible. This is very coherent. What person wrote in Genesis doesn't fly in the face of what somebody wrote in Revelation. It's one unity. So that the Bible is very unique. There's no book like it in the world. It's true. That's the second thing I wanted to point out. It's the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth. It's totally free from error. There's no errors. Okay? Now, people want to say there's errors in it, and they'll say, oh, but look at this here. This can't be right, and this can't. And they'll come up with all kinds of reasons, but you know what the bottom line is when those things are brought into the open, when the original languages, whether it was Hebrew, Aramaic, or Greek, whatever language you're looking at in the Bible, those things are easy to deal with that seemingly look like in English that they don't agree. All right? It's not like the Quran where you have just out-and-out contradictions. The Bible's authoritative, everybody. It's unique. It's true. Thy word is truth, the Bible says. And it's authoritative. What does that mean? It means because it was written by God Almighty. He spoke, the same God that spoke into existence, the universe. He said, let there be light, and it happened. God's words are very powerful. God's words are amazingly powerful. And when He speaks, it comes to pass. Let there be light. Let there be oceans. Let there be stars. Let there be a sun. He's speaking into existence through His power and might, the universe we live in. You know, Brother Cook put that stat up there about how much energy it takes to generate a little packet of sugar. It's mind-boggling. It's mind-boggling. And God didn't just create a little packet of sugar, He created a universe. So, not only is it unique, it's true, it's authoritative, the one that spoke everything into existence is the one that says, look, this is the way to go. If you try to do life with any other blueprints but this blueprint, you will have misery, you will fail, you will not have a pleasant stay here on planet Earth. You know, somebody said B-I-B-L-E, Bible, that stands for Basic Instructions Before Leaving Earth. That's really good. The Bible is the blueprint that God told us to live by. So, we're going to look at just the first 8 verses of Psalm 119. The first 2 verses of the book of chapter Psalm 119, this gigantic chapter, the first two lines begin with the word blessed. Blessed. And today, I want to talk about this topic. The key to God's blessing. Notice how I put that singular, the key. I could talk about keys to God's blessing and go to other places in the Bible, but you know what, everybody? Today's message just sums it up. This first part of this huge, long psalm, it just starts us off on the right foot. So we're going to look today at the key to God's blessing in your life and mine, in our church, everything. Family, marriage, finances, the key. We're going to look at it this morning. Let's pray together. Father, I just ask that you'll use this in all of our lives today, that we'll leave here different people today than when we came in. That, Lord, the Holy Spirit will come in such power that everyone will be convinced that this is the truth and that we need to abide by it. Lord, there is not anything outside of this word, Lord, that we are called to follow. There's no other book. There's no other religion. There's no other teaching, Lord. Your word is truth. And so, Lord, help us to humble ourselves today, to think, to ponder, and then, Lord, to decide which direction we're going to go in our lives. And we pray this in your precious name, Jesus, and for your sake. Amen. Amen. All right, the key to God's blessing. Have you ever been in this situation? Can't find your keys? I know none of you ever have. Now listen, right over there I have an iPad. It's so bad, I not only lose my keys, one day I put my iPad down on a chair in my office, and then somehow I got all these magazines I get in the mail. And so I needed somewhere to put them, so I just put the magazines down just temporarily, right, on that chair. Well, you know what? I forgot all about the iPad. And so, you know what? I looked everywhere for that iPad. I looked everywhere. Couldn't find it. And so, I just said, you know what? Somebody must have taken it. Somebody must have come in. And I don't know who took it. Who knows? But it's gone. Because it's not in this house. Or it's somewhere where I hid it so well, I can't find it. It's in the attic underneath the insulation. I don't know where it's at. But it's a... Well, anyway, it took me a year later. I'm like, you know, I need to go through these magazines. My iPad, because I had the original iPad. That thing was so slow and clunky. Oh my goodness, this new iPad was so much better. So I was missing it for a year. I know that none of you have ever had this. But when you lose your keys, they're really important. They got your door keys on it, maybe your office key where you work, and maybe your, and for sure your car key. You got your house, your office, everything. There's all kinds of things on there. Okay, you need your keys. Well, you know what? We need today the key that this passage is talking about. Okay, these eight verses, say, Pastor Bob, what is the key? These eight verses I showed you, precepts, commandments, statutes, the law of God, all these words for the Bible. The Bible, the Word of God, God's words to mankind is the key to you having blessings on earth. Okay, go to India where they're not following the Bible. They're following the tenets of Hinduism. And they say that cows are gods. And so there's 8 billion cows walking around and a bunch of Indian people walking around that are skin and bones. Why? Because they're reading a book that's not true. And the book they're reading says, don't you dare kill those cows because they're gods. And so they're starving to death over there, but cows are everywhere. Okay, see, life doesn't work when you're following the wrong book. All right. Now, let me show you how God's Word, in fact, I already showed you, but I want to show you how obedience to God's Word is so prominent in the psalm. Then I'll get you to the three benefits of God's Word. Okay, in verses 1 and 3, we're told to walk in God's Word. Live by it. Walking with God in the Bible, walking in His Word, is obeying His Word. If you have a good walk, then you're going to have a holy life. You're going to have an obedient life. So, just like when you have a new baby, the baby can't roll over, it can't crawl, it can't walk. It has to be taught, and you have to hold its hands as it gets bigger. First it learns to crawl, it rolls over, and then it crawls, and then it begins to, you can try to get it to walk, and then it'll fall down, but eventually it begins to walk. That's just how Christianity is. When you're a new Christian, man, you're just learning. It's a struggle. Then eventually you can start rolling over. You feel so much better. And you get, and then eventually you can run the race. The Bible says, run the race with endurance. Run it. Run it. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher. So you can't walk, then you can crawl, then you can barely walk, and then you can walk really well, and then you can learn to run, and then you can run the marathon. So walking, verse 2, obey. Walking is obeying. Verse 2, keeping is obeying. Verse 2, keep the word of God. Verse 4, keep the word of God. Verse 5, keep the word of God. It's repeated. Verse 8, keep. I think God's trying to get a hold of us. Hello. Whoa, that's pretty hollow. Hey, you there. All you out there in Bible land. He's trying to knock on our brains and say, you getting the idea here? Walk is just another word for keep, obey, and so are those. They're all talking about, listen, you want success in life? Learn it and live by it. You want misery in life? Leave it on your shelf and do your own thing. You want misery? It's really simple. It doesn't take a rocket scientist. Okay? So six times in just eight verses, the first eight verses of Psalm 119, we're told over and over to obey. What else? What else? Those who are blessed, what else do they do? What else do people do that are blessed by God? Okay, verse 2. Those who seek Him with the whole heart. Those are the ones that are blessed. What else? Verse 6. They look into. Look into. What do you mean, look into? Basically means ponder, observe, study. I'm going to look into this. Folks, it takes time. It takes time. Verse 7. It's amazing. This is all packed into these eight verses. Learn. So you've got obey, 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 keep, seek it, look into it, study it, learn it. Okay? Hey, does it do you any good to take math classes and then you finish the year and somebody says, here, you hand somebody $5 and you bought something for a dollar and they give you a quarter back. And because you don't know math, you go, thank you, and you walk away. They owed you $4 and they gave you a quarter, and because you didn't learn it, it's not any good just to read the Bible. You want to seek it, look into it, and learn it. You got to learn, understand it. Okay? So the person who is blessed walks in the Bible, keeps the Bible, seeks the Bible, learns the Bible. Let me ask you, do you? Man, listen, everybody, we have to, again, there's a lot of things in our world that we can do. That get our attention. There's so many things. So much technology, you've got to be careful that. Take time. The old song said, take time to be holy. Speak oft. Speak often with your Lord. Okay? Three benefits. And then we'll take the Lord's table. We'll remember Jesus and die for our sins. Number one. Three benefits of being a diligent, sold out seeker of God and His Word. A seeker of God and His Word. Number one, the benefit you get, number one, you get a wonder, you get the wondrously, now notice, the wondrously superior blessings of God. Listen, Satan's got blessings for people. Are y'all listening? Satan's got blessings for people, but he only shows people the front yard. He's like a realtor that says, this is a great house. Look at how beautiful. Look at the pillars. look at the beauty of this house. And he doesn't take you inside. You remember that movie years and years and years ago with Tom Hanks, The Money Pit? Yeah. Who else was in that? What was that girl's name?
Shelley Long.
Shelley Long. The Money Pit. They buy this, or inherit or something, they get this huge mansion. But you know what? For 2 hours, it's nothing but craziness. It's the house collapsing around them. They're putting money into it. They're trying to fix it. But you know what? Satan's that way. Satan says, hey, listen, wouldn't you like to do this? Doesn't that look real? Doesn't that appeal to you? Wouldn't that make you feel good? And listen, everybody on earth, there's so many people in misery, they want to feel good. So immorality, theft, so easy to steal rather than to work hard. Wow, why should I work for 5 hours to earn 40 bucks when I can steal that in 5 seconds? See, Satan shows you the front, how wonderful it would be to do this or that evil, but he doesn't show you the backyard, which is a junkyard. He doesn't show you the rest of the house. Plumbing's all leaking. There's junk in the ceiling because there's holes in the ceiling and so on and so forth. And I better be careful about shining this laser on our ceiling. It might collapse on me if you're ready. But anyway, but you get the idea, okay? You get the idea. God's blessings, learning this word, you say, Bob, how do you know? How do you know? I'll tell you why. Because yesterday I noticed it was August 20th. That's a very special day for me. Because in 1979, on June 20th, I got saved. But in 1979, on August 20th, I got set free from drugs. 2 months to the day after I got saved. I was sitting, now listen, I didn't go to church that day. But God let me know he wasn't happy about that. I was going to this concert, Carlos Santana, Comiskey Park in Chicago. And the guys that I went with, man, they're rolling the joints, they're making joints, and they're passing them around, and one of them comes to me, and I'm sitting there down on the end of a bunch of friends, and I'm holding that thing. Now, I've been saved for 2 months, and I'm looking at that, and you know in the movies where a little angel gets up on one shoulder and a little devil gets up on the other? Okay, I'm sitting there, and I'm looking at that thing, and I'm looking at my watch, and my watch says 11:15 a.m. Ooh. That's when my pastor's preaching, right now. So God, the angel on this side, he says, Bob, right now your pastor's preaching. Yeah. Oh. And then he says, Bob, you're my child. What are you doing with that in your hand? Okay. I passed it back, everybody, and guess what? I said, Lord, I'm not touching that stuff ever again.
Amen.
Just like that. I'm not touching it ever again. And you know what? I walked back to my car, and the guy that took my $5, the empty lot, he didn't own the lot. He was standing there, and there were 100 cars pulling in there. 5, 10, 15, 20. He's acting like he owns the lot. And everybody's just pulling, oh, only $5. So he makes $500, and everybody goes into the concert, and when everybody leaves, that same guy goes and he breaks all the windows out of every car, and he's stealing stuff, stealing radios. Now, I had my 70 Chevelle. Okay, anyway, but I had that 70 Chevelle, and in the back of the shelf in the back of the car by the back window, I had these big speakers. And I had a beautiful stereo, and I had a power amp under the stereo, and I was serious about music, okay? I wanted to hear that music when I drove, and I wanted everybody around me at the light to hear it, okay? So anyway, guess what? Every other car was dashed in, except mine, that had probably one of the most expensive stereos. And you know what? It's just as if God said to me, hey, you know what, Bob? You did what was right. You do what's right and follow me, I'm going to take care of you. And you know, I never forgot that. I never forgot that. All the other, the policemen are sitting there, shh, 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 pulling off, writing these things up and handing them to people. They're just handing them to every person, so they're all coming, and you know, I'm just sitting there. God takes care of you when you follow his blueprints. You follow the devil's blueprints, you're going to have misery. Okay, you're going to have misery. Okay, blessed are the undefiled in the way. That word is beautiful. The undefiled. Oops. I guess I put, you know what, everybody, I put the wrong scripture in there. I might have the right one, but on there it's the wrong one. It should be the first two verses. Blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they who keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. Twice in two verses. Blessed. Blessed. Those are wondrously superior blessings, everybody. Two times. You'll be blessed if you're undefiled. That means unblemished. You know in Leviticus? Take a lamb that is without spot. Take a lamb that's without spot. Take a lamb that's used like 50 times. Take an unblemished lamb, an unblemished lamb, an unblemished. Blessed are the unblemished who walk down God's paths, who walk in the way. The way is the path. They walk down God's path. They walk according to his word. Blessed are those who obey his testimonies, his word, and that seek him with the whole heart. Are you sold out to God? Are you sold out to his word? Are you sold out to reading and understanding it and following it? If you're not, today's a great day. Just like I was sitting in that Comiskey Park, holding that thing, I made a decision. You know what? I need to quit this, and I need to do more of this. And you know what? I don't know. I can't even remember. After that, I can't even remember if I ever missed church after that. Because, man, God got a hold of me because I was missing church. First time since I had been saved 2 months earlier. You know, Warren Wiersbe, he said the world can give you pills, but it can't give you peace. The world can give you video games, but it can't give you victory. You sit in front of a video machine 24 hours a day, you know what? You're not going to be a victorious Christian. I'm not against video machines, I'm not against pills. But a pill can't give you inner peace. A video game can't give you spiritual victory. Wiersbe said that the world can give you entertainment, but it can't give you abundance. And again, nothing wrong with a movie, entertainment, but you know what? When you get drunk on those things. I'm drunk on technology. I'm drunk on, and you never take, you know what? Listen. What you guys have on your phones and those Bible study things where you can just touch a word and it'll bring up the meaning of the word and bring up an English or bring up a Greek or a Hebrew lexicon, a dictionary, oh my goodness, it's so amazing what they have. You know, God said in Proverbs, those who seek me diligently, it's talking about wisdom, those who seek me diligently will find me. Those who seek me diligently. It can't be half-baked. It can't be like, well, you know what, I'm just not sure. I want to enjoy my life down here on earth. But Jesus said, whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. You lose it for the kingdom and the glory of God. Then you're going to find your life. Not if you're walking a fence. You know what, if I had kept living the way that I was living when I got saved, okay, do I want to be a party animal or do I want to be God's servant? Do I want to go to parties and do what I did all the years I was unsaved, or do I want to do what God wants? You can't walk the fence. You can only do that so long, and you have to decide, am I going to be on this side of the fence or that side of the fence? You can't walk the fence very long. And by the way, if you've already jumped off onto the wrong side, you really need to get things right with God and get back on the other side. You know what? You might be dabbling in things outside of God's word and the things of God, listen, you're cruising for a major bruising. Because first of all, God will wake you up. He'll wake you up. He'll say, listen, that's not the way. The Bible's full of teachings about sorcery and divination and necromancy and all these things of the dark world and the dark side and that invisible world that's so real around us, but we can't see it. The Bible's very clear on that. And listen, those kind of things, you have to run away quickly from them, or else God will bring a wake-up call to you and show you that's not the way to go. Okay, those who seek me diligently will find me. Jesus said, you'll know the truth and what? The truth will make you free. What makes human beings free?
Truth.
The truth. the truth of God's word. Now look, not a mistaken belief of it about God's word. That doesn't set you free. Okay? Okay? Not a mistaken belief about the Bible. Like, there's all kinds of churches, they have some really odd beliefs. And they think that Christians ought to do this, or they ought to do that. And they think they're following the truth, but what really sets us free is when we know the truth. What is God really saying here? And by the way, that's one of my responsibilities, is to help you understand the truth so you can be blessed. Alright? So that's number one. Number one is a wondrously superior blessing of God. What's the second benefit? Two more. The second benefit is this. Oh, alright. That's alright. We'll just skip that. The second benefit is this, everybody. Perfectly timed intervention of God. How many of you, you don't have to raise your hand, how many of you need God to intervene in some way in your life, your family, your work, your income, whatever it is, how many of you need God to intervene in some amazing way for you? Well, everybody in this room, we would all raise our hand and say, me, I need God's help. Well, verse 4 says, and unfortunately, I have the wrong scriptures up there again. I should have paid more attention to that. But anyway, that's what I wanted on the last screen. But let me read to you verses 4 and 5. You commanded us to keep your precepts diligently. Oh, that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. He said, oh, Lord God, that my life, that it was steadfast in keeping your word. Then I would not be ashamed. Oh God, I wish that I could keep your word better. Then I wouldn't be humiliated. I wouldn't be in the situation I'm in. The psalmist is saying, Lord, I messed up, and something's not right, and I need your deliverance. I would not be ashamed when I look into all your commandments, okay? Verse 8. I don't know if I have this one. No, I don't. I'm so sorry. I really messed up this morning, but verse 8 says this. I will keep your statutes. Oh, do not forsake me utterly. I rehearsed it for you earlier. Verse 8, positively. Oh, set me free. Oh, but he says, oh, Lord, don't forsake me. Don't forsake me. Hear my cry. Lord, I want to keep your word. I want to follow your ways. Don't forsake me, Lord. He's saying, in reversing it, Lord, set me free. Come to my rescue. Deliver me. Help me. Man, that's the way we ought to be. We ought to be seeking God. Because the Bible says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved or delivered. It's deliverance. It's talking about saved people getting deliverance. Because the verse before was, how can they call on him in whom they do not believe? See, first there's the believing, and then comes the calling. How can you call on him if you don't believe him? And by the way, if you don't believe the verses that God will come to your rescue, you won't pray. You won't pray. You know what? You'll just say, oh, I'll figure it out on my own, Lord. If you really believe God, you say, oh, I need God's intervention. Well, whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be delivered. So you call, and you call, and you call. I was reading Nehemiah this week. Nehemiah is going around the city of Jerusalem. It was built. The people moved back in 70 years earlier under Ezra. And now 70 years later, there's still no wall around the city. There's still piles of rubble everywhere. They've been living that way for a long time. And guess what? Nehemiah started going through there. And you know what? He was fasting, and he was praying. And you know what it says? That he did that for many, many days. He didn't even tell others what was in his heart. He just said, Lord, he started seeking God. And God, whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be delivered. Now, listen, you may not be delivered in the way you think you should be delivered, but God will give you some deliverance that's going to be what's best for you. You know, it's not going to be like Jim Carrey and just answer every single person's prayer in one moment. The whole world gets an answer to their prayer. They're just chaos. God gave every human what they really wanted. I mean, what they wanted, and it would be a disaster. Now, I had this guy's picture up. You saw this pop up here real quickly. This guy's name is Jack Abramoff. 10 years ago, he was really famous. He's on Life, on Time Magazine, on other magazines' covers. Why? He was a Washington lobbyist. He's a Washington lobbyist. And guess what? He was doing all kinds of criminal things under the table. He was really messing up. And he, along with 21 other people, were indicted. And he was sent to prison for 6 years. And did you know what he said to Time Magazine? He was being interviewed by them. And this is what they said. He said to them, he said, God sent me 1,000 hints that he didn't want me to keep doing what I was doing. But I didn't listen, so he set off a nuclear bomb. And that's what I was saying earlier. You keep going the other direction from God and from his word. And you know what? God, he's a loving God. He's just like a father. If a father sees their kid heading toward the edge of a cliff, they don't just go, well, you know what? Kids will do their own things, you know. They'll just go their own way. No, a father's going to do something drastic to keep that kid. He's going to run over and scoop him up, okay? And you know what? God sometimes will do something drastic in people's lives to wake them up. And they're not pleasant sometimes. Like, sometimes they'll get in a car wreck. They'll be sitting there going down the road, and suddenly somebody smacks them so fast they don't know what happened, and they get knocked off the road, and suddenly their car's wrapped around a tree, and they're knocked out. They didn't even know what happened, and they wake up in a hospital room, and they say, what happened? And then they find out, oh, some guy came out of nowhere, smacked your car, knocked you up, and then hopefully the person will look at that like a nuclear bomb and say, God was trying to tell me, don't go there, don't go there, don't go there. And I went there, and finally he had to wake me up somehow, some way, set off a nuclear bomb. And then, you know what though? Some people, like we said in days past, they're like donkeys. They dig in their heels. They are stubborn, they don't want to listen to God. Well, God will set off bigger bombs. And then finally, he might take a person off planet Earth. But that's the last resort. So, God will intervene, okay? Number two is the perfectly timed. Where's we used to say God, when he allows troubles in our lives, when he allows problems, he's got his eye on the clock, he's got his hand on the thermostat. He knows how long, he knows how hot. God's in control. Okay? Satan, he lets Satan turn up the fiery furnace, but he always keeps his hands on the thermostat. Never more than you can handle, never more than you need. He's very kind and gracious. But listen, God's not a dummy. He's kind and gracious, but he also spanks his children. He also sends bombs, quote unquote, to wake people up in life. He gives them problems so it'll wake them up to seek him and to seek his word. Okay, number one, God's superior blessings. That's the first benefit. Number two, his incredibly timed. He comes to your rescue when he wants to, not when we want him to. Amen. Nehemiah is out there week after week, day after day, month after month. Finally, God comes through for him. But you know what? We wait on God. We wait on God. Finally, number three, and then we're going to have the Lord's table. The third benefit is the life-changing transformation of God. Okay? I will praise you. Yay, I can write scriptures. I will praise you with uprightness of heart. What is uprightness of heart? The psalmist is saying, I'm going to keep your commandments, and Lord, I'm going to praise you. I'm going to thank you, give you thanks with a holy life. I'm going to give thanks to you. I'm going to show you. Hey, listen, that's what I did. When I got saved, everybody, in June 20th, 1979, I was so happy and so thankful. I would just get down on my knees and say, thank you, Lord. I'm going to thank you with my lips, and I'm going to thank you with my life. I'm going to thank you. I'm going to show you how thankful I am by obeying you, by getting in the Word, by taking the Lord's Supper, by witnessing to other people, I'm going to show you how thankful I am with an upright heart, with a holy life. That's how you show. You know what? You know this. If you give somebody something, and number one, they don't ever say thank you. Or number two, their thanksgiving is sort of like half-baked. Here, I want to bless you. Here's $100. Oh, thanks. Really? Yeah, sometimes that's the way it is. You help people, and there's not their... Hey, listen. Think about this. Jesus healed 10 people. I can't remember what he healed them of. Were they not walk? What was it?
Lepers.
Oh, lepers. Thank you. That's right. 10 lepers. Okay, so they look like death. You know, they look like walking death. Their skin has turned white and it's just gross as all get out. I mean, they really, really, it's like just infection all over your body. Now listen, you would think if somebody, if you were just had this gross disease and people are going, ah, and running away from you, you would think that if somebody healed you completely and you look fine, everything looked good, you would be like, hallelujah. You know what? 9 of them didn't even come back to thank Jesus. They took off, probably looking for their girlfriends that dumped them months earlier. I will praise you with a life of integrity once I've learned and obeyed your word, which delivers me. I will praise you with integrity, with thanks. I'll thank you, praise you, with a holy life, with integrity. When I learn the word and I keep it, and you deliver me. That's the positive. Oh, don't forsake me is, oh Lord, deliver me. You get it? See the order here? I'm thankful, and I'm showing it to you by my holy life, because I've learned the word, and I've obeyed it. I've learned it, and I've obeyed it. Now, Lord, come to my rescue. Ooh. Wow, how powerful is that? How powerful is that? The word of God, the word of God, the word of God. Keep. Obey, obey. And the blessings flow. The life-changing transformation. Look what James said. Almost done. Boy, do we need this. Be doers. Everybody look at that. Look right there. Be doers of the word. Be obedient. Not hearers. Okay, everybody here is hearing God's word. But God says, don't just hear it, do it. Don't just, if you're just a hearer, who are you deceiving? Your own self. I go to church every Sunday. I haven't given anything to God in 24 years. I haven't witnessed anybody. Well, in fact, I never have witnessed anybody. See, you're just deceiving yourself. If you think when you see Jesus, he's going to have a great big grin on his face and say, thank you so much, faithful servant, for serving me so well. And, oh, you didn't serve me. Okay. No, he's not going to be a big smile. You're deceiving yourself. If you think you're going to have God's blessings here on earth and eternal rewards in heaven, you're deceiving yourself if you're just a hearer and not a doer. He or she who looks into the perfect law of liberty. There's another way the Bible's spoken of. What's the perfect law that sets you free? The Bible. Whoever looks into the Bible, the perfect law of liberty, and continues in it, does it. It is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the word. This one will be blessed in what he does. God blesses obedience. He doesn't bless just hearing the Bible. I'm all for hearing the Bible. I'm all for hearing it preach. I listen to it when I get up in the morning and shave. I messed up my little thing that plays it nice and loud off my phone, my Bluetooth thing. It fell off the shelf and it broke. I was so sad. So I had to go buy a new one. But this is great because not only do I get to hear the Bible in the morning, but my neighbors on both sides of my house get to hear it too. It's really a good one. Man, it cranks out the Bible. But anyway, guess what? That's wonderful, and I'm glad I do it because I just get to learn the word more. But guess what? If it doesn't help me, to obey God more, it's just fluff. Don't be a hearer only, Bob, deceiving yourself. Yes, I listen to the Bible every morning when I should. It don't matter. It doesn't get you that benefit. It's doing it. This one, whoever's the doer, this one will be blessed. Okay? We got to put it into practice. Okay? So in Psalm 8, the psalmist makes a promise to God. He says, Lord, you say, keep your statutes, keep your precepts, keep the law of God, keep the commandments. You say that over and over to me. I will keep your statutes. Lord, I'm going to do it. By your grace, with your help, I'm going to do what the word says. I'm not just going to have good beliefs. I'm going to have good behavior. Not just good doctrine, but a good godly life. Okay? We need both. We need both. And so, how do you do that? You do what I put on the screen way, way back before, right at the beginning. Seek it. Learn it. Do it. Seek after it. Observe it. Ponder it. All those things that Psalm 119, 1 through 8 talks about. Okay? So listen, everybody. Don't be just a hearer of the word. You go out of here and be a doer of it. But you know what? Get in there and understand it. You shall know the truth. You got to know it first. The truth will set you free. If the Son of God sets you free, you'll be truly free. You'll be free beyond your comprehension. Okay, men, would you come forward? We are going to remember the Lord Jesus today. We're going to remember Him. Once a month, everybody, we set aside time as a church family. Now, I know that many of you pray, and you get up in the morning, or you go to bed at night, or at lunchtime, you seek God in prayer, and you say, Lord, thank you for saving me. Thank you for dying for me. You do that many, many times during the month. But you know what we do as a church family? As a church family, once a month on the third Sunday, we pull aside, and we take a few minutes, and as a family, we remember Jesus. That not only was He slaughtered, not only did He die a brutal death, but that He, or not only that He suffered the brutal suffering, but that He actually bled and He died. He lost His blood and He laid down His life. And this little representation of Jesus' body here reminds us of the pain. It reminds us that a crown of thorns was put on His head. His back was slashed mercilessly with a cat of nine tails. A horrible, horrible whipping. And so we need to remember Jesus. So men, would you stand? That's why we look at this little host here. Do you need two, Gerald? Okay. Alright. Alright, everyone, let's bow our heads for prayer and we'll remember Jesus' death and the suffering in His body. Father, thank you for your people. Thank you for their hunger for your word, Lord. Give them grace as they put this message into practice. And Lord, thank you for your death on our behalf. Your death on the cross, Lord. Thank you for how you suffered, that you might pay for every single sin that we would ever commit. We praise you for it today, Lord Jesus, and we pray it in your name.